Good evening to those that are here and those that are viewing on TV. I'm gonna call this meeting to order. Let's have a roll call, please. There it went that time. Stand for the invocation. Mr. Hammond will lead us in the prayer.
Let us pray. O gracious God, our Father, we thank you for another day, and we pray that thy blessing will continue with us as we are in this meeting tonight. Bless each commissioner individually, and then, Lord, bless us all collectively, and forgive us for our transgressions and our sins. Bless the people of Pitt County that we represent, and help us to be mindful of that at all times. We thank you for what you've already done and what you're still doing, and most of all, what you're going to do. In your holy name we ask it all. Amen.
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 I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
We have a motion on the agenda.
Mr. Chairman, I move that we accept the motion.
Second.
All right, let's vote.
Mr. Chairman, I wanted to ask that consent item on the consent agenda number 4 be pulled for further review.
Item number 4.
Okay, that's a motion. Do we have a second on that? To remove that item, or do we need a motion to remove that, Madam Attorney?
If the maker of the motion to approve the agenda would agree to pull that item, then it could be included in what you've done. If the maker of that motion not so, then you'd need another motion at this point.
Which one is it talking about?
It's 4 on consent.
Number 4 on
social
consent
work.
To be
social work proclamation.
Thank you, Doug.
Yeah, I'll make a motion to be exclude that. That's no problem.
Okay, he needs a second from me.
So Mr. McGlohorn made the motion. Mr. Farley, are you going to second that?
Sure.
Okay. So that'll be removed, and that'll become number 6 on items for decision?
Yes, sir.
Okay, first up we have public hearings. Mr. Rhodes.
Good evening, Mr. Chair, members of the board. We have one rezoning public hearing for your consideration tonight. This is for Brian Carowin. Some of the site details about this particular request. It is on 20 acres located at the intersection of Page Road and also Mills Road. It is requested to go from rural residential to rural agricultural conditional district. And just as a reminder, with these conditional district rezonings, we have a site plan that's submitted with the application, and also it details the number of uses that are being requested at the same time. In this particular case, we're looking at 5 separate uses on this tract. It's a rather large tract, all somewhat horticultural related or agricultural related. Landscape and horticultural services, garden center and retail nursery, outdoor fruit and vegetable market, Christmas tree sales, and blacksmithing. Some of these are also, as you've noted, seasonal uses. On the screen before you is the outline of the parcel in question. Again, it's almost 20 acres. Just to orient you, at the very top of the screen is Hollywood Crossroads. You'll see just west of that is D.H. Conley High School. Here's the track and the school itself. You come down Mills Road towards the east, it's right at the intersection with Page and Mills Roads, and you can see it's a fairly linear-style parcel that runs fairly deep off the roadway. This is also a picture, and I'll show you a diagram of the site plan in just a minute, but this is leading off of Page Road. This is the access point to the property, and you can see it leading back. This is the path that leads back onto the bulk of the tract. The future land use plan, which is also always something we want to refer to when we're considering these rezonings, this shows it as suburban residential. And again, some of the details for that, this would include residential land uses, including single-family manufactured home subdivisions and parks, limited multifamily development, as well as commercial, office, light industrial, and all of these uses should meet locational criteria. And in these cases, for non-residential uses, typically that means frontage onto a state road. And in this case, Mills Road is a fairly substantial state road as far as traffic concerns. The land designated in suburban residential is distinguished for a greater potential for development and for the inclusion of a broader range of land uses. As far as existing land uses in this area, predominantly residential, as you can tell, kind of in this orange color throughout here. There's a mobile home park nearby, a small church here at the corner at the intersection of McGowan's Crossroads, and some of the other areas you can kind of see around this particular tract primarily are undeveloped at this point. The current zoning, this is an area that's somewhat transitional as far as our zoning map is concerned. Rural residential is the current zoning for this property, and you can see just south of there, the darker green is rural agricultural as you move further away from the larger portions of Winterville and Greenville. So it's right on the fringe area. And for color's sake, I will tell you what the rezoning does, and it is in alignment with some of our principles of rezoning. This particular tract, if rezoned, will go to rural agricultural, which again is adjacent to other properties that are zoned similarly. This particular district is intended to accommodate very low density residential uses, as well as several other non-residential types of uses. It also reflects the diverse nature of land uses within a predominantly rural area, and as I've shown, a lot of this property is undeveloped in this vicinity. The conditional district rezoning, as I mentioned, is for specific uses, and we've highlighted those already. Landscape and horticultural services, Christmas tree sales, outdoor fruit and vegetable market, garden center and retail nursery, and blacksmithing. So the site plan that's been submitted with this, this is the 20-acre tract in total, again, bordered in red. The area shown or highlighted in yellow is the improved area of sorts, where you'll have roadway, parking area, and some of the other buildings associated with these uses. Also, to the rear of that area is about 3 acres that's intended for some of the horticultural uses as far as growing shrubs and trees and so forth. Little blow up of the area that's going to have the primary improvements to the property. There's already an existing agricultural building shown in blue here. Again, the area in gray is either the parking or driveway area. There are 3 buildings proposed here. One towards the front that would be the office area and some other storage areas there as well. Also an outdoor storage area for some of the display area for some of the landscaping, the plants and vegetable products out front. And also you can see highlighted in green here is some of the screening and buffering that's proposed. not only along the property line, but adjacent to the parking area. There are about 9 parking spaces being proposed. With this, we, as staff, typically provide to you our recommendation with this. We believe that it is consistent with the land use plan, and it is also, for a number of reasons, consistent because it's adjacent to rural agriculturally zoned properties, and it is located at a major intersection in the rural area. Also, in accordance with the objectives of the land use plan, we've made sure that we've got additional screening and buffering for the areas to minimize any conflicts with adjacent properties. Second item here is that we believe also that it's reasonable in the public interest. The applicant has submitted the request as conditional zoning, which allows additional conditions as needed to be applied to it. And the proposed uses are appropriate for this rural location with the buffering and screening that's coming along with it. The Planning Board also has reviewed this at their February 25th meeting and recommended unanimously approval of this request. So 2 motions before you, adopting the consistency statement and also approving the conditional district request tonight. With that, Mr. Chairman, we're ready for the public hearing.
Thank you. We'll declare the public hearing open. Is there anyone that wishes to speak on this matter? I know I've got several people signed up under public addresses, but I'm assuming, based on the similar addresses, it's for this issue. Mr. Griffin, Clyde Griffin. Thank you.
Good evening.
Good evening.
I live on Page Road and have for over 12 years. The area is primarily a agricultural area and family area. I am against the rezoning. I oppose the plan for bringing all the traffic in on Page Road. Page Road is congested in the morning and in the afternoon with the traffic of the kids going to and from D.H. Conley. You're talking about, during different times of the day, adding more commercial traffic on Page Road that's not designed for. You're talking about truck traffic he's going to sell to other landscapers. He wants to sell to other people to buy shrubs. He wants to have a blacksmith shop. All of the things he wants to do is going to increase the traffic on Page Road. I've been past his property that he currently has down on Mills Road, and in times past, the property's been very cluttered. Now, I will admit that the property is not that way right now, but in times past, it has been cluttered. But since having bought the property on Page Road, he's had a broken-down truck sitting out in the middle of the his field for the past 5 months. I think he's developed this property without any regard for the neighbors. When developing the property last summer, his workers worked on it pretty much 7 days a week. When I enjoy a quiet Sunday afternoon, I had to listen to equipment moving up and down on his property, which I feel is disrespectful. His right to do it, but I feel it's disrespectful when your neighbors enjoy a quiet afternoon. From the beginning, his intention was to develop this property so that he could move his business there. I think it's kind of deceptive that he's made the improvements, and now, only now, when he cannot go any further, he's coming to you asking for permission to do what he wants to do and has been planning to do. Even this past week, my wife received a call from his surveyor saying that Mr. Carowin wanted to be a good neighbor. Well, I believe if he wanted to be a good neighbor, he would have come talk to the neighbors before he began to do anything and share with us what he wanted to do. But he's moved ahead with his improvements, expecting this board to approve what he's done and to approve what he wants to do, because he has put capital into that property. And I think that's the wrong way to do things. And I'm asking the board to deny his rezoning request.
Thank you, Mr. Griffin. David Butts.
David Butts, I thank you, Mr. Chairman, and the county commissioners for listening to us tonight. I live on Page Road next to the property which is seeking to be rezoned. And like Mr. Griffin, I'm concerned about the traffic problem that will be created there by the rezoning being replaced next to Page Road, off of Page Road. You're probably going to hear something about traffic count figures from someone else. But those figures are old. From our experience, we who live on Page Road, the bulk of the traffic on Page Road is from 7:30 a.m. to 8:15 in the mornings with the school kids who are going into D.H. County School, and they use us for a shortcut off of Mills Road and all of the subdivisions out off toward Mobley Bridge Road and in that area. They come through there, and it sometimes there's a bottleneck backed up there on Mills Road waiting to make that turn. They will probably tell you that it's better to enter on Page Road with their property than in Mills Road. Mills Road has a greater line of sight to the traffic than Page Road. Between where the drive is and the end of Page Road to Mills Road, probably so a couple of 300 feet. And they will tell you that it's easier to do that, come out Mills Road and come out Page Road and go to Mills Road than it is to enter from Mills Road. But they've still got to go out to Mills Road anyway once they come out Page Road. And they're going to be moving heavy equipment. They're going to be dispersing workers, trucks, and all of that in the mornings, but doing the heaviest part of the traffic for the kids. So my point is that the line of sight is better actually on Mills Road for the drive. And I'm opposed, as Mr. Griffin is, to the entire project. But I'm hopefully you will not okay it. There are two drives already on the property on Mills Road. Now, they possibly will say to you that the state will not allow them to use those drives because of the proximity to the corner. But I checked with DOT in Washington, in Beaufort County, and my understanding is that they have not asked to do that. Also, the drive that's there, when the permit was made, was not made for a commercial drive, and that's what you're going to turn it into if you okay this zoning request. So there's a lot of things that are going on there. Maybe somebody needs to go out in the morning and sit there and watch this corner during school hours like we watch it and hear and see the things that we see. There's already been some near problems out there. There's the end of Page Road is a huge turnaround there, and they use it a lot of times for U-turns and things of that type. And the line of sight there is short, and that's part of the problem. Besides that, I really, to be honest with you, I don't want this commercial drive in my yard, and basically that's what's going to happen if you allow this rezoning. Thank you for your time, and we appreciate it.
Thank you. David McGowan.
I'm David McGowan. I live at 2138 Page Road, and that's next door to David Murata. And my concern is, of course, I agree with him on his stuff, but my concern is what kind of chemicals will be stored over there, because you know out in that area we have bugs, we have worms, we have all that kind of stuff, and pesticides and all that, that's poison. And I got a deep well. I will not privileged to have Eastern Pines water on that road. And I'm concerned about any future problem that might occur with chemicals, because if you're in that kind of business, you're going to have chemicals stored if you retail and wholesale and you tend to your own stuff. So that is my concern as far as what he is doing. And another thing is he's put bushes all the way down the ditch. This is the ditch bank, and this is the ditch. Well, he's come right on the edge of that ditch and set bushes, and they claim they're going to grow 12, 15 foot high, I think. And if they do, we can't shrub the line ditch. Our farm is together, and he's nowhere to put dirt on his side or if he was had to clean out the ditch and all of that. And we want to keep the ditch clean so the land will drain. So that's a line ditch. But if he puts something out there and it's right on the edge of that ditch, leaves are going to fall and our man can't shrub our side or bush hog it. And that's what I have to say, and I appreciate the time.
Thank you. Shirley?
She's here for
another matter? Okay. We'll have you come back up if you're here for a different item. Okay. Is Mr. Spruill, are you here for this rezoning request?
Good evening, Commissioners. My name is Steve Spruill. I'm representing Brian Carawan tonight here at this rezoning request. I have heard some of the opposition there, and I do want to address a little bit of that. Mr. Griffin mentioned that apparently Mr. Carawan wasn't trying to be a good neighbor. I think, and we think that he really has. He was a little hesitant to contact them himself. And I contacted all three of the people that have spoken in opposition tonight earlier last week and asked them if there was anything that Mr. Carawan could do within reason to help the situation. He'd be willing to talk to him about it. We have not heard back from any of those people concerning that request. Some of the things Mr. Carawan has done go over and beyond the requirements of the zoning ordinance. By ordinance, the vegetation requirement that he would be required to put in to screen the parking area would probably cost him around $2,400. He's already spent around $8,000 out there in vegetation in an effort to screen his property from the neighbors, those homes right beside him, to try to make things as good for them as he could. He also recently put up an agricultural building. I think there's been some talk that he's jumped the gun, perhaps, on what he's here tonight requesting from you, but that's not the case. That building that's there is an agricultural building, and so that was put in a long way off of the road in an effort to keep it from being right in the face of the adjoining property owners. And that incurred additional expense for him and additional cost of utility services to get lines back to that he would not have had to do if he'd have put it closer. So there are some things that he's done that we feel like he's made a real strong effort to make the property better. But all that said, I think the main thing is that in addition to all those things, his rezoning request is in compliance with the comprehensive land use plan. The planning board has approved it unanimously. The planning staff is behind it. And so for those reasons and some of the other ones I've stated, we think he has made a real good effort to comply with the requirements of the ordinance, and we would appreciate your vote tonight in his favor. If there's any questions, I'll be glad to try to answer them.
Does anyone have any questions? Mr. Owens.
One of the gentlemen said something about egress and ingress from a different road than what you're projecting. Have you viewed that any, if that would help?
Yes, I'll address that. We contacted DOT. Mr. Butts said that our data was old, I believe, a while ago. Actually, we just got this data from DOT. It was the latest data they had that they could provide me. The traffic count was done in 2012, so I guess it is a couple of years old. But it was the most recent that they had. The traffic count on Mills Road is 5,100 cars a day. Page Road, by comparison, only has 330 cars a day. If you do the math on that, that's about 17 cars per second coming at you on Mills Road. I wouldn't want to be trying to pull out on that road in a farm truck, nor would I want my wife and children pulling out on that road. This gentleman intends to build his home on this property, so he doesn't want to mess it up. He also tells me that when he comes out on Page Road with his business equipment, he does not turn right and go to Mills Road. They turn left on Page Road and go out to Highway 43 that way. So from a pure safety standpoint, just the numbers of the traffic count, 5,100 cars a day versus 330 cars a day, to me, it's a no-brainer where you put your driveway. I understand their concern about the people coming around that intersection at a high rate of speed and cutting the corners, but I don't think my client can be responsible for the illegal actions of others, and we do take that comment seriously from them, and that's something that I'm glad they pointed out, and we appreciate that. But again, we think the traffic count is just makes it very clear which way you need to put your driveway.
Are you saying that you come in on Page Road to Mills Road, that is a stop sign or some control light?
There is, that's right. There's a somewhat of a T-intersection, I guess, from Page Road up to Mills.
But you got the same amount of traffic down Page Road, of course, in addition, as you do going the other way, don't you?
Well, Page Road has...
I mean Mills Road, excuse me.
I don't know about that. All I know is 5,100 cars a day on Mills Road. I'm not sure I understood your question.
I guess my point I was trying to make, what difference from your standpoint would it make to come in Page or come into Mills?
Only from the traffic count, primarily. The
traffic's going to be same in that area, isn't it?
No, sir, not for him. If he turns left from his property...
Well, I'm not talking about on Page. I mean to get onto Mill.
Okay, yeah. Anywhere up and down Mills, you're going to hit that. Okay. I guess if I'm approaching that intersection at a stop sign, I feel safer exiting at an intersection with a stop sign than some driveway 250 feet away.
Thanks, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Ms. Ward?
A question about the trees.
Okay.
That apparently have already been planted along the ditch. Can you speak to that? How close, I mean, I assume they are part of the buffer. Is that right, James?
Yes.
Okay, are they being planted according to what we expect, where we expect them to be planted as far as the buffer's concerned?
Yes, ma'am, I think so. In fact, the trees that you refer to in bushes that are already in place are not any that are required by the ordinance. They are ones that he has put in over and beyond ordinance requirements in an effort to make things more palatable for the surrounding neighbors. And they have been placed in a strategic place to honor a electric easement that GUC has required to serve the farm building in the back. So they're in a tricky spot, and they are close to the ditch. But Mr. Carawan assures me that one of his goals is to keep that ditch open and not let it grow up. He's tending this as a farm, so he doesn't want it to become impassable and non-functional either.
Okay, and that ditch is the responsibility of the adjoining landowners.
The ditch is on the line, so I would assume they share responsibility of that.
Okay, thank you.
Mr. McLaughlin?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Griffin brought up the concern about selling of items, and I think some of it was noted in the summary information. Also about the heavy trucks coming in and out of the neighborhood, equipment moving up and down on his property, and the blacksmith shop. Were there any intention to have hours extended for operation in terms of selling these things? And also, before you mention the answer to that question, there were also, I think, Mr. McGowan, the situation of chemicals will be stored in a nearby area near his home.
Okay.
Could you address some of those?
Sure. Concerning the chemical issue, I was talking to Mr. Carawan about that. The chemicals that will be on that property are no different from the chemicals that are on that property or on any farm around here. There are the chemicals he uses in raising crops. So, I mean, they are just like any farmer, and he is, you know, required by law to, I'm sure, treat those as appropriately if they're hazardous materials. So, so yes, there will be chemicals, but they will be no different than any other farmer uses on his crops. And then I believe you asked the other question about the timing. You know, we had talked about that a little bit, and his intention is, I think, given that it would be an 8-to-5 kind of operation on any given day. But if you would look closely or take a look perhaps at the attachment we sent in with the application describing his intended uses, we don't think it's going to be an everyday affair by any means. It's going to be sporadic people coming in, calling in, making arrangements to stop by at 2 o'clock on a Saturday afternoon to pick up a truckload of shrubs. So that's what we envision happening.
Commissioner Williams?
I'd like to ask Mr. Rose, when your committee considered this proposal, I'm very interested in residential peace for people who've been living in the area for a long time, and drainage. You know, I've come from an area that was flooded. And if the trees that he's planted will grow to block the ditch, that will be a problem for the water runoff. And if you all looked at that, number one, and the next problem I wanted to know was, with the possibility of some commercial activity and the peace of the people who live there, in sleeping and having a good quality of life, how would that, you think, affect this particular project?
Number one, as far as the rezoning request before the planning board, the drainage was not considered. The ditch was not considered. We looked at it strictly as a land use proposal. It is an open ditch there now. The landowners that share that line, the boundary line between the two properties, would be responsible for continued maintenance there. The commercial operation, this is in a rural area. There are farming operations nearby. Farmers oftentimes, depending on the weather, can work on the weekends as well. The commercial activity that you're speaking of, there may be additional trucks coming in, as Mr. Sproul has mentioned, coming in at various times to pick up whatever plant materials they need. I don't know, given the scale of this and given what's been included in your package, that it would be a day-in, day-out type of operation. Our understanding in sitting down with the proposal or the person that's proposed these activities is that it would be sporadic at best. So I don't know that you'll see a full-scale Lowe's Home Garden Center or anything like that. This is more of a small-scale landscaping business, horticultural business.
I think you told me one time when this kind of thing is submitted to us, you needed to know whether or not we went out there. I'm not that familiar with the area, and I did go, and I did look, and I did not talk with anyone while I was out there because I wanted to make a good personal assessment of it. And I did see the yellow strings on each side of the bushes, but I didn't know what kind of bushes or trees or vegetation it is. And the bushes should help with keeping noise down, but I don't know what kind they are. But I was concerned about the ditch because I lived in a flood area. Thank you so much, and I appreciate it.
Thank you. Ms. Ward, you had a follow-up?
Two other things. One, James, I think you could, and I think you did just kind of answer it, but I think it needs to be, because when you read this thoroughly, you realize it's not a setup like a nursery, mm-hmm. like where people go in and pick up pansy plants or seedlings or whatever with a lot of traffic going in and out. It's like if I was building a building and I wanted trees and bushes, it's more like for commercial, like I would go in and purchase by appointment and let him know how many bushes or trees I wanted and load them up and take them. Is that?
That is our understanding in the proposal. That's exactly what it is intended for. And one reason we get a narrative like you've gotten in your package tonight, if at some point we feel like it's gone to a higher level, a higher intensity, there may be cause for updating the site plan that you're seeing tonight, and it may be back before you if there are changes of use. Now, one reason you've got five uses in front of you tonight is he wanted some flexibility, especially seasonal flexibility in what's being provided out there. So you've got the full
package.
Composite.
The other thing is, I did not go out there because it's kind of in an area where I've done a lot of riding as far as schools are concerned. And the most of the area across that ditch is farmed also, correct?
Yes.
Okay, I don't know whether these gentlemen are farmers of that land or not, but it's pretty much around a lot of farmland around it, which I think you indicated.
It also. Is, yes.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Ward. Mr. Owens had a follow-up. Oh, go ahead, Tom.
I heard what you just said, but and that triggered something. It's going to be small scale now, in theory, based on what we're reading here. But is there anything that prevents it from getting bigger as time goes on? And you had made the comment something to the degree that if it gets that level, then it might be back before us, but what triggers that?
Be a number of things. For example, if there's an issue with the driveway as far as DOT is concerned, if there's a certain amount of traffic going in and out of there, there need to be improvements for the curve radii coming out connecting onto Page Road. That would be one indication if there's been some issue with gaining access to the property, either ingress or egress. So that's one thing. It could be complaints from adjacent property owners. We see cars coming in and out day in, day out at all hours of the night. And I think what you've heard here today, you're looking at normal business hours from 8 to 5. However, this is the good news about a conditional district rezoning. If you felt compelled to add hours of operation as a condition, you could do so. So, and that would carry on through for any of these uses that are included on here. So there are a number of ways. We would be monitoring, of course. We go out annually to look at these sites that are either have conditional uses, conditional use permits, or conditional district permits. So that's another way we may be able to pick up on something.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you. Mr. Owens, do you have anything else?
Over the years, sitting in the position that this board sits here tonight, we've been confronted with issues similar to this. And I feel compelled to want to improve our economy, but I also feel compelled to help the people that live in the houses there. Now, there's been some conversation about attempted communication between the parties. James, you have not participated with that.
We have not, other than notifying them of the rezoning from our office. We did have a cancellation with the planning board meeting because of bad weather, and I did also call these folks personally just to let them know about that. But no, we've not sat down between these two parties as a mediator.
I have gleaned from what has been said here by the property owners that have homes on Page, and the person making the presentation about this new zoning that they want, that there may be some room there for them to negotiate. And I personally like to see them do that and come back to us.
I like that.
I like that idea, too.
I agree with you, Mark, and I was waiting until we closed the public hearing to make that as a suggestion and even in the form of a motion. But I guess the appropriate time to do that is after we close the public hearing, right, Mr. Chairman?
That's correct.
I'd like to ask a question. Being new, is there an opportunity such as that they appear before your committee and the two groups talk, or no?
Well,
or does that happen?
At the planning board level, there is an opportunity for citizen comment that was had on February 25th. So, but we have not sat down jointly with these two groups and try to negotiate anything.
But we have done that in the past, what you just said.
We have done that on special occasions in the past.
Sat down.
Yeah. Anybody,
Mr. Hammond,
the planning board.
Yes, sir, Mr. Chairman, and to the board. I would like to commend the gentleman that counted the number of vehicles that was on Page as well as on Mills. I was born and raised in Winterville, and I used to frequent the area between Worthington Crossroad and the stop sign beyond the school frequently. And one thing y'all can be proud of now, there's a lot more blue lights on that stretch of road than what it used to be. And I hope all is well with the citizens that live in the area. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Hammond. Is there anyone else that wants to speak for or against this? All right, with that, I'll declare the public hearing closed. What's the discussion or motion from the board?
Mr. Chairman.
Yes, Mr. Garrison.
I am one that always like to have things worked out to the satisfaction of everyone. We are not at that level on this project yet. And if I look at the one side, the strict adherence to our standards and point out that the planning board has unanimously approved this. It is consistent with our land use plan, and our planning board is recommending to approve it. Now, all of that lends significant weight to me in making a decision. But then on the other side, I am also very, very concerned about our citizens living in a harmonious relationship with neighbors. And that is very, very important. Now, we've had the citizens that live out there, and I'm very familiar with this area. I live out there myself. Mm-hmm. I have expressed some concerns. And some of those concerns, I believe that Mr. Caron could probably sit down with them and address. And I really think that this board is not in a position this evening to make a decision on this issue. I would like to try, as Mark has already pointed out, for the citizens, the community,
and Mr. Karen to get together to see if we can't work out some of these differences. The concern about chemicals, I would be concerned about chemicals if I had a deep well. The concern about the shrubbery on the ditch. The concern about entrance on Mills Road versus Page Road. It looks to me like these are things that could be worked out and could be discussed amongst both parties. And since it is Mr. Karen that is trying to have a change in the zoning here, if I were him, I would be the one that would initiate this community meeting to see if we couldn't sit down and talk out some of these differences. And I hope that both parties are willing to do that and see if we can't come up with a mutual conclusion where, and Mr. Karen says, I understand he's going to build his house out there. So he definitely wants to have a good, harmonious relationship with his neighbors, not only because his business is there, but also because his home would be there. So I would like to see the group sit down and see if we can't work this out and come up with some mutual agreed upon conclusions to the reasonable satisfaction of both parties.
That's your motion.
Is that a motion?
And I would put that in a motion.
Is there a second?
Second.
Yes.
Any further discussion, Ms. Ward?
Two things. I'd like to understand that James and someone, whoever he chooses, would sit down and be kind of the mediator as they have done in the past in issues like this. I think that's important instead, you know, to have someone there as the mediator. And I would like this time thing, somehow that's kind of stuck in my head, that if it could be 9 to 5, you know, with maybe a chain up when they're not open, and that might help as far as the time with the traffic, with the school traffic early in the morning. So that's just something else I'd like for you to add to the discussion and anything else that they come up. So I'm in favor of this.
Any further discussion?
Mr. Chairman, I just want to be clear as to when this should come back. Is there any discussion about that or when these parties have been resolved?
You think 90 days is enough time?
I would think so.
Okay. We'll set it for 90 days or within our first meeting at or beyond 90
okay.
days.
Okay. Very good.
All right. If there's no further discussion, let's vote.
Was Ms. Ward a second?
She did.
We
say.
Had a yeah.
I second.
Melvin seconded, and I seconded his second, and then I belabored.
Oh, I got to vote one of these.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you. All right, next up, we have recognition of some Eagle Scouts.
Motion to send the letters of recognition.
Second.
Appreciate your recognition.
I just assume there's no discussion on that.
Got to vote for the Boy Scout recognition.
I voted for the motion.
It didn't show, Dave.
Well, this evening, the Pitt County Board of Commissioners are recognizing two young men who have achieved the highest rank in the Boy Scouts of America organization. And as part of achieving that rank of Eagle Scout, the board is going to recognize them with a certificate. And if we can ask first for Jacob Crass and his family to come forward, and we'll present this to you. And as we always try to note, there's a very small percentage of the young men who are in the Boy Scouts of America that actually achieve the rank of Eagle. I think nationwide it's maybe 2% thereabouts, and in Pitt County it's probably about double that percentage. So we are proud of the young men in Pitt County. Would you like me to read this?
Please.
Okay. For the viewing audience, you can see the certificate we're reading. It says, Certificate of Appreciation is awarded to Jacob Crass for achieving the Eagle Scout Award. And for his project, he landscaped the front side of the picnic shelter at River Park North in Greenville and worked with the park's coordinator to get the exact kind of native plants he wanted for the project. This is presented by the Pitt County Board of Commissioners on the 16th day of March 2015, signed by the Chairman Glenn Webb and the Pitt County Board of Commissioners.
Thank you. Thank you. Congratulations. Mom and Dad, say anything?
anything?
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Yeah, we're very proud of Jacob. Hopefully we get two more that will follow suit.
Yes.
Y'all want a picture?
That'd be great.
Y'all want to be in the picture? We can get somebody to take it.
Deputy Mealy?
We have a volunteer.
You want to come?
Amateur with the camera.
Make sure you get his name in case the picture doesn't turn out.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Thanks again.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Switch places.
Okay. Second young man and his family, Clay Bastnight Collier, will come forward, please. And as they come forward, just want to note that these projects are no small feat in terms of doing an Eagle Scout project. There's much planning and preparation, as well as hours of time spent by the young man doing the project, as well as other young men within the troop or other folks, the father or the siblings who help execute these projects. So, again, we have another certificate, and I'll read this again. Certificate of Appreciation is awarded to Clay Bastnight Collier, pronouncing that correctly? Okay. For achieving the Eagle Scout Award for his project, he constructed a sensory trail at the Rocking Horse Ranch across from Rock Springs Center in Greenville, North Carolina. Again, presented by the Pitt County Board of Commissioners the 16th day of March, 2015, signed by our chairman, Glenn Webb. Mr. Webb?
Thank you.
Congratulations. They enjoyed that air conditioning.
Say anything? Thank you, Mom and Dad. You guys want to say anything?
No, thank you very much to the Commission for recognizing our new Eagle Scouts and Craig County to be a scout.
We're very proud of both of them. Do you guys want a picture?
Yeah.
Sure. Do we have a camera available?
Sure.
We do.
Here comes Mike's coming.
Okay.
So I'd lay in my phone, and I'll just text it to you later.
That's a pro with a camera.
We can, here, you want to, we can use yours too?
Yeah, we can just use mine.
Okay.
You ain't going to have him doing this.
He was ready, we weren't. That's why he's an Eagle Scout.
It's called be prepared.
All right.
Thank you.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. You see who had the camera, though.
Thank you.
Appreciate it.
Thanks again.
Good job.
All right. Next item on the agenda is our public addresses to the board. We have two people signed up. Ms. Morrison, were you signed up for a public address? Okay, you're first on the list. Come on up. Madam Attorney, if you just want to go over our rules for the public address to the board, please.
Well, the county welcomes comments on matters of public concern. I'll keep your time at 3 minutes per speaker, and we just ask that all comments be respectful.
Get her to pull this down.
If you'll pull that mic down to you so that we can hear you. I did pronounce, that is Morrison, correct?
It is.
Okay, go right ahead.
Good evening. I'm Shirley Morrison, and I'm chairman of the Pitt County Community Schools and Recreation Advisory Council, and I just wanted you to know that our council supports the updated comprehensive recreation and park master plan that you will hear about later this evening, and hope you will give positive consideration to its adoption. Thank you.
Thank you. All right, next signed up we have Ms. Brenda Harris.
Good evening. I'm Brenda Harris. My address is on file, and ever since the accident, I don't move so fast. Not anymore, anyway. I want to tell you about town meetings that we're fixing to have in April, and then in May we're going to have two, one in the morning, one at night. We'd invite you to come, because if you don't give us a platform for us to detail the facts of the discrimination that we believe exists, we're going to be using the Ferguson model and how the Justice Department came in and we intend to explore government and taxes, assessments, as well as collection policies. We're going to explore our courts and why 73% are Afro-American that go to prisons, and I'm told that we have white prisons and black prisons. I'm not sure what that means, but I do intend to find out. We're going to talk about our schools and how there's a vacancy of 300 here, and we're moving trailers in so that we can fill one school that doesn't have any more capacity up, and I'm wondering what the racial balance is. You might want to look at D.H. Conley. We're going to be talking about the hospital and why I have so many people call me and say that they're in the waiting room and their loved one has died because they didn't get triaged properly. And $173 million that you're supposed to answer to goes with, I accept it and no more questions. We're going to be talking about social services and why a local administration, which is county administrated, use different sets of rules. We're going to be talking about jurisdictional foreclosures and why it's so important that we have septics and integrity of rules because they lend to make mortgage failures and banking fraud. So I promise you that I will walk in integrity. We're combining our Afro-American community, our elderly community. We are combining the people that you give no voices to. We're going to be looking at every aspect of Pitt County, and we're going to be building Pitt County as the model. And hopefully, we're going to have it ready by August when you have the North Carolina Association of Commissioners here, because I believe we will be able to lead Pitt County. I thank you for your time. This is the holiday season of Easter. May the Lord bless our risen Savior that we can serve and know that he loves us all.
Thank you. Is there anyone else who wishes to address the board at this time? All right. Next up, we have under items for report.
All right.
Judge and Ms. Larson.
Good evening, folks. My name is David Leach. I'm Chief District Court Judge here in Pitt County, and I appreciate the opportunity to come before the board and give a report on the status of our drug treatment court here. Being passed around to you is a set of documents, the first of which is a letter from one of our graduates graduated in last month. And I think I'd like to take just a minute to read it to you. My name is Shelley, and I'm 25 years old. When I was 13, my parents separated, and that's when I began to use drugs. At first, I would just drink and smoke marijuana socially at parties, but after a little while, that wasn't enough. I began to use every day. When I was 16, I started dating my weed dealer, and he used cocaine and opiate pain pills. At first, I would only do pills and cocaine once or twice a week, but then I started using pills every day and eventually needed them to even get out of bed. Then when I was 21, my father passed away from cancer. I had built a high tolerance to the pills. They didn't work anymore. So I started shooting heroin and cocaine. After about 6 months of chasing drugs, I got tired of the way I was living. My mother had turned her back on me from constant lying and stealing from her. So I tried to get clean. I did the methadone program twice, the Suboxone program, went to Black Mountain 90-day program, but I relapsed every time. Finally, my probation officer got me into drug treatment court program. While DTC is very time consuming, I believe that this is what helped me get clean and remain clean. The constant drug screens and random screens also keep you on your toes because you know if you test positive, you'll get a sanction. Another benefit of DTC is the team shows you that they care, even when they're hard on you, And when you first get clean, you need that support because you've probably alienated your family and all your friends are gone, so you have no one to turn to. Finally, the requirement to attend self-help meetings is also a big help. As long as you follow their suggestions and work the steps, it will help you free you from your past. Since I started and graduated the DTC program, I'm now in my third semester at Pitt for Human Services Substance Abuse. I chair meeting for NA, have a beautiful 7-month-old daughter who I'm able to be there for, and have almost 13 months clean. I owe it to the DTC program for helping me get on the right road to recovery. When I met Shelley, it was in November of 2013. She was pregnant and pretty much homeless and in drug treatment court. Shelley's baby was born clean and sober, and Shelley's been clean and sober for 13 months. And I'm very, very proud of her and very proud of the drug treatment court team that I feel like has helped her get there and stay there. Let me give you just a history, a little bit of history about drug treatment court here. In the late 90s and early 2000s, court systems around the state sought to better address problems caused by and problems of folks who have chronic drug usage. It was never a state mandate and never statewide, but when local programs developed, the state provided some support. In 2005, Judge Joe Blick really pushed us hard to do this, and I agreed to provide the court time and assign him to do it, and I served as his primary backup until he retired in 2013, and I've continued to do it ever since. The direct state funding that we did have ended in 2011. It's a testament, I think, to the validity of the programs around the state that virtually all the programs that were in existence remain in existence today, funded in some other fashion. Local counties have stepped in with support. We've gotten some grant funding. That's how we've stayed current with the program. And we appreciate Pitt County's willingness to help with grant administration through the Sheriff's Department to provide in-kind matches and relatively modest cash matches. We're funded through September. Let me introduce or tell you who's on the drug treatment court team. First, an assistant district attorney, Chris Johnson. Chris is here in the audience. Second, an assistant public defender, Stephanie Williams, who couldn't be here. Next, Devin Scully, who's a probation officer who keeps up with folks. Chad Clark from your Sheriff's Department Electronic Monitoring Unit, which we often have folks on electronic monitoring. Trudy Halstead from Port Human Services, the treatment provider. And Megan Hartzog from my office to keep the records. The second sheet that you've got there under the letter is what we ask folks to do while they are in drug treatment court. And it's not an easy thing. What's expected of a drug treatment court client? Appear in court biweekly. They have to come to court every 2 weeks. They see the same judge, me, every 2 weeks, and the same team members every 2 weeks. They have to participate in treatment, which can run from outpatient treatment to intensive outpatient to inpatient treatment when it's needed, attend a number of self-help meetings, case management sessions. They're drug screened every week regularly and random drug screened. When they don't know it's coming, color code. They call in Monday, Wednesday, Friday. If their color is red, they have to go in that day to be drug screened in addition to the other drug screens. They have to report to probation regularly, follow phase curfews, depending upon what phase of the program they're in. We try to help them increase living skills and positive relationships with the community, get stable housing. Sometimes that takes halfway house first. Compliance with sanctions, and we expect folks when they come into drug treatment court not to do everything perfectly. And it's a graduated set of sanctions. Increased treatment, increased number of self-help meetings, community service, additional court attendance. Try and have them come to a court where either they see me or they see children that the Department of Social Services has had to intervene with. Sometimes being there when you don't have your own case starts to help you think about, hey, there are other folks like me and that there are tragedies in my life that maybe I could prevent. And then periods of incarceration. I mean, there's no secret that we use short-term confinement as a part of the sanction in the court. They have to abstain from all mood-changing, mind-altering substances and criminal behavior, complete the three phases of the program. It's a minimum, by the time you get through everything, 1 year requirement for folks to graduate. Pay the probation fees and court costs, submit papers to us when they go from one phase to another, and attend aftercare after they graduate. It's not an easy thing. I'm going to ask that you hear from a couple of folks who've actually participated and are participating in the court for just a couple minutes. David?
My name is David Taylor. I graduated from the drug treatment court. I tried a numerous of things to justify my addiction, but my addiction, I found out, was a disease. Like living with any other disease, I did not know how to live my life with this disease. I had to learn what the disease was. Through drug treatment court, I received the education, the caring, the support that I needed to accomplish things in life that I should accomplish. I was a father, and I became a dad. I was a student, and I became a scholar. I was a boy, and now I stand before you as a man. I tell you all these things to say this. I'm a student at Pitt Community College. I know Dr. Massey personally. A year ago, I wouldn't have known any of you guys. I'm receiving the Academic Award of Excellence.
Excuse me, David, can you raise that mic just a little bit?
Okay, sir.
Thank you, sir.
I'm receiving the Academic Award of Excellence on Friday. I'm a member of the Phi Theta Kappa, Gamma Beta Phi, Sigmas. All these accolades are a direct, it's direct. I could have never done this by myself. I can use the word I, but we, all of us, are the result of why I'm standing here. Sometimes I get choked up by the things that mean the most to me. And I get choked up easily about drug treatment court because I care so much about it. I am an intern at the Real Crisis Center because of drug treatment court. I believe that pro-social activity is not only necessary, but it's something that I feel I have to do. I believe you have to pay it forward. And if you guys see it in your heart to pay this forward for the people to come behind me in drug treatment court, I would deeply appreciate it. Thank you.
Thank you, David. Now I'd like you to hear from Cecilia, who is a member of the drug treatment court now. She's about halfway through, and she's doing very, very well.
Hello, good evening. My name is Cecilia Lisk. I'm here on behalf of Drug Court Treatment Program. Also, David did a great job. These people, they help us. I was incarcerated last year. At this time, I was incarcerated for 5 months. And since I've been out, I have been clean and sober, and I have been under the guidance of the drug treatment program. When I got out of incarceration, I did not have anywhere to go. Also, instead of relapsing and turning to drugs, they held out the hand to me, and I accepted it. I stand today. I have a home. I'm clean sober. I got my kids back in family court this past Thursday. I just want it to be able for people like me, mothers like me in the future, to have this opportunity as well, because drugs is a disease. It's not something that you pick to have happen to you. And this day in Greenville, it is very serious. I've been here my whole life, and I was not always on drugs. I know Mr. Hammond. I know Mr. Owens. I used to wait on them every day at Harvey's restaurant 11 years ago. I was not on drugs then, but I got caught up with the wrong crowd. And it took me down. And it's because of these people and what they've helped me with, I've gotten back. I feel now more like that person than I was ever. You know, you just got to pick back up and keep going. And with their support, I've done that. My mother just recently passed, and I did not think I'd do it. But I made it through without relapsing. And I know it was the support of this program. And I just wanted to come here on behalf of them and let everyone know it does work. These funds are not just being wasted, because I am being a productive member of society. And without them, I'd just be probably running up and down the road doing things I wasn't supposed to. And I just want to support them. Judge Leach does an awesome job, and we are very thankful to have him. Thank you.
Thank you. Money. I want to thank the Board of Commissioners for allowing the sheriff to do the grant administration. We've had grants now for the past several years, and we would not have been able to do that without the sheriff's and the board's support. We're now applying for a grant from the Governor's Crime Commission, and I guess I ought to apologize to both Scott Elliott and Melissa Larson for the late timing in getting that application in and asking their permission. Frankly, just caught up. It caught me a little unawares. Judges are not great planners, and I'm sorry that I put them kind of in a little bind on a time crunch. Let me let you talk with someone from the Sheriff's Department as well about money. Melissa?
Thank you. I'm so glad that you guys gave us the opportunity to come tonight and tell you about all the wonderful successes that the Drug Treatment Court has provided to the Pitt County citizens since 2005. It does always boil down to money in some form or fashion, and we all understand that part of the mission of the county of Pitt is to provide a healthy, safe environment for our citizens, but to do it in a cost-effective manner. And so from a sheriff's office perspective, we do have to look at the jail costs that come with substance abuse issues in our community. And within your packet, you will find a blue chart, and it may look a little complex, but I'm going to read you through it. And what it is, it's a snapshot of four of the participants that are in or have been through the drug treatment court and the jail costs that we have incurred as a result of the criminal activity associated with the substance abuse issue. At the top, you'll see that you've got one male and three females that I'm going to talk about. Of course, changed their names for their privacy. To the left, you'll see information about their jail history prior to entering drug treatment court, and then their jail history after being in drug court. So the first one is Doug. Doug's first alcohol drug offense was back in 1991 at the age of 24. He advanced to a more higher potent drugs and property crime shortly thereafter. He has over 37 criminal charges on his state record, and he has a 10-year history with the Pitt County Detention Center. He's come in and out of our facility 25 times in the last 12 years, and it totaled 180 days. And I want you to know, this isn't someone, none of these people are coming in and they're serving a sentence of, you know, 100 days. This is in and out, in and out, in and out, in and out. And this is what these numbers reflect. His 180 days was about $15,000 in taxpayer funds. That is a lot of money, and he's just one of hundreds that come in and out of our facility. But since entering into drug court in late 2013, he's been crime-free, and it took the drug court to help him overcome his long history of crime and substance abuse. So you can see in that first column for Doug, he served once drug court started, he's been in 540 days since he started drug court. And of those days, he only served zero in jail. So that is a great success for him. The next person is Kathy. Her first drug offense was 9 years ago at the age of 23. You can see from the chart, she's been charged with various crimes from prescription, street drug offenses, driving offenses, assault, and larceny. She has over 20 criminal charges on her state record, and she has an 8-year history with our detention center. She stayed in our facility 12 times, encompassing over 158 days. It has cost over $12,000 to the taxpayers. But since entry into drug court, she has not been charged with one single offense, and she still hasn't served any days in our facility. And again, on her chart, so she's been in drug court for 120 days, and she's served none in jail. The third person is Stella. Stella's first drug offense was at the age of 17. She's committed such crimes as credit card theft, larceny, and driving while impaired. She has 21 criminal charges on her state record, and her history with our jail spans over 6 years, totaling $6,000 in and out. She's now 25, and she's successfully completed the drug court, and she has her whole life ahead of her at this young age, and we're really glad that the drug court helped her choose the better path. So she was in drug court for the past 480 days, drug court or free, and she only served 9 days in jail, and her 9 days were for sanctions that we had to give her. The last person is Barbara. This one's really complicated because it demonstrates what happens when people are unable to stabilize and benefit from the structure that drug court provides them. Barbara's now 53 years old. She had her first drug offense at the age of 25. She has a 13-year jail history with us. That covers 27 jail entries, accumulating over 332 days at a total taxpayer cost of $26,000. She has over 78 charges on her criminal record. You can imagine what her employment prospects look like with that. And the months that she was enrolled in drug court, she didn't have any charges. She didn't have any jail days. She was fine. She was benefiting from the structure. But not everyone is successful in that structure. There are times where they misstep. Unfortunately, she came in and out of the drug court 2 or 3 times. And on her last termination, within 5 months, she had been rearrested, and she is back in and out of the system. And since then, she's been arrested 2 times. So not everyone succeeds, but her story demonstrates that the absence of the structure that drug court gives and the accountability and the professional treatment can impact one's journey to recovery. Judge?
Guys, what I think is the bottom line is that you're looking at not only saving lives, but saving taxpayers' money. And who wouldn't want to be at that intersection? As I said, you guys have graciously supported us with our grant application. We think we'll know late April or early May about whether we get grant funding or not. Right now, our funding goes through September. If we don't get that grant funding, I'm going to be back. A number of counties around the state have picked up the cost for this type program. And the bottom line cost for a year of this program is right at $50,000. I hope you guys will support us if we need it. I hope I don't have to come back and ask you for it. I say again, I appreciate the opportunity to come talk with you about drug treatment court. It's a real special place to see somebody who's kind of at the end of their rope in life and who comes in with no friends and no home and a history of disappointment. And they turn over there and they, you know, the probation off, they're used to getting negative consequences from everybody they meet in the system. You know, the probation officer's fussing at them for not following probation. Defense lawyers fussing at them, you didn't do what I told you to do. The prosecutor, hey, I gave you a deal last time, this time I'm going to ask the judge for a hard time. And the judge, you again, hey, I told you last time this was going to be what happens, off you go. When folks come into drug treatment court and they have their first slip up, what do they hear? They hear, we're sorry you had the slip up, but we believe in you. You can do this. We're proud of you for getting those first few days clean. We're proud of you for being honest about your drug usage. We support you. We want to see you string together a few more days. And even if they look at me and they say, you know, that old guy in the black robe, he can talk the talk, but he hadn't walked my walk. He has not walked in my shoes. They can look around in that drug treatment court and see folks who have walked in their shoes, who are being successful in different stages of the program. They can see the David Taylor. They can see Cecilia Lisk. They hear every other week, I'm doing it, I'm doing it well. It's a real special court, happens every other week, Friday mornings. You're welcome to come. I'd love to have you come. But I appreciate the opportunity of coming before you. Thank you.
Does anyone have any comments or questions for the judge? We appreciate your presentation. I think it's a first step in recognizing disease behavior and criminal behavior, that there's a difference. And I think it's a worthy program. So thank you for coming.
Thank you.
Give my regard to Betsy.
Next up, we have Ms. Booker.
Good evening.
Good evening.
The Pitt County fiscal year-to-date combined collection rate for real and personal property is 96.43. That same rate a year ago was 95.66. That is a 0.20% increase in real and personal property, and the overall increase is 1.10. And if you will look at the last page that I talked about motor vehicles, the state taking those over. If you'll look, they send out the invitations to renew, and each one of the months in that last Excel spreadsheet columns is 100%. So that is a tremendous help to us in our tax collection rate, because the invitation to renew is sent out versus a bill, and it's handled by the state, and the funds are sent to the county for those motor vehicle people who choose to take their invitation to renew and go to the DMV.
Motion to accept.
Motion to approve. Second.
Thank you.
Mr. Holder.
Good evening, Mr. Chairman.
Good evening.
Commissioners. What you have next before you is our monthly financial report for the general fund as of February the 28th. This report does represent 8 fiscal months of the fiscal year, or approximately 66.67%. of the year completed, through those 8 months, we have collected revenues at a rate of 74.6% of our anticipated revenue budget, and we've spent right at 63.9%. As compared to a year ago, our 74 and 63.9% is very comparable. Last year through February, we were at 74 and 62.5%. We are seeing a slight narrowing of our net revenues over expenditures as compared to a year ago. Some of that was to be expected with some of the increased expenditures that we budgeted and planned for in the current fiscal year, but we still anticipate that we're tracking at a rate that is very comparable to the prior fiscal year. One of the highlights that I will point out, and I think I did this a few months ago, but with the change in our tag and tax legislation and the fact that our tax office is not processing motor vehicle billing anymore, we have been able to reallocate some resources to working through some of the delinquent taxes, and that is actually yielding additional revenue. We're able to better collect on some of the outstanding bills. So with that, Mr. Chairman, would seek your approval of the report.
Is there a motion?
So moved.
Is there any other questions or comments for Mr. Holden? Mr. Elliott.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Just a few things. Under the manager's report, item A, your next meeting dates, you'll only have one meeting in the month of April. That'll be Monday the 13th at 9 a.m. And the first meeting in May will be Monday, May the 4th at 9 a.m. Item B, just want to bring your attention that annually Pitt County government participates and celebrates in the National County Government Month, which is sponsored by NACA, the National Association of Counties. And this year's theme is going to be Counties Moving America Forward. The keys are transportation and infrastructure. We'll have more information about you about the different things that we will be doing as a local county government to recognize that month. Item C, I want to bring to your attention that the state DSS will be holding a listening session here in Pitt County regarding child welfare. This will be on March the 27th from 2 to 4 p.m. This will be conducted at Cornerstone Church. Item D is the annual Shepherd Memorial Library Breakfast for elected officials. This will be on Monday, April 27th at 8 a.m. And this will be the Board of County Commissioners plus City Councilmen, as well as the members of the local legislative delegation who join for breakfast at the library to hear information about the library and also possibly any legislative needs of the library. Two other items that are not on the agenda, one that we just received deals with a follow-up to what we reported in the last meeting in terms of our follow-up to the breakfast that you held with the Pitt County local legislative delegation. One of the bills dealing with the relieving the interest and penalties on motor vehicles for any motor vehicle that is prior to July 1st, 2013 has been filed in the Senate jointly by the sponsors, Senator Davis and Senator Pate. This is Senate Bill 273. So we're pleased to report there is some traction on this, that the language that Ms. Gallagher had submitted to the legislative writing office has taken traction and become a bill and is getting some movement. And I think Janice may have two other things to follow up on.
Well, there were three particular goals that we were working on to present some affirmative legislation to work with our delegation. I was pleased that Senate Bill 273 is moving forward and has already been filed. We have also submitted drafts on the other two that Scott mentioned last meeting, one having to do with a study commission for subdivision streets. We have prepared a draft and are working with Senator Pate's office and bill drafting on that one. And then the third one had to do with flexibility with 911 funds and more particularly the backup PSAP requirement, that public safety answering point requirement that we were concerned were going to cost county significant dollars to duplicate the 911 centers. We have proposed legislation there that I've drafted, and I'm working with Representative Martin on that as well. So we have all irons in the fire, and we're moving full steam ahead.
Good. Thank you.
One other item, Mr. Chairman. You press on today's paper, as well as in your weekly info packet. We do have a retirement of a department head. Mitch Smith has announced his retirement and will be retiring at the end of this month. And there will be a retirement celebration on March 27th at the Ag Center. And you're invited if you would like to attend. Just let the clerk know and we'll have you signed up. And that's all I have.
All right. Next, we have our items for consent. Is there a motion?
So moved.
Let's vote. Dr. Massey?
Chair Webb.
Good evening.
Commissioners, Mr. Elliott, thank you for having me come back tonight. You may remember that I was primed to speak to you on February 16th, and little Mother Nature got in the way. But what a great day it was today, and I'm very pleased that we're able to have a chance to talk with you a little bit about capital programs at Pitt Community College and our proposal to the county commissioners in this regard. First off, let's see. Just a few items. We're having a joint press release with East Carolina University on the economic impact of both Pitt Community College and East Carolina University on our area. Just a couple factoids from that. The impact of Pitt Community College, just our payroll and expenses, is over $50 million. That's per year. And that is money that comes back to Pitt County that wouldn't otherwise if Pitt Community College wasn't the size that it is, or if we weren't here at all. And this does not include the ripple effect, obviously, of the alumni and all the students and people that we serve. Just in terms of an annual return to investment of taxpayers, Pitt Community College records, according to the national authorities, a 16.7% return on that investment. Again, it is an asset for Pitt County and for all of Eastern North Carolina, and I'm so proud to be serving as the president at PCC. Just a quick recap of our recent history in terms of enrollment. You'll see from these numbers that we are continuing to have a strong enrollment at Pitt Community College. It's plateauing a little bit now, in line with much of what's happening across the country. When the economy goes up, community college enrollment usually flattens or goes down a bit. Pitt Community College has held pretty steady at a high level, and this is total credit students over the past year, 12,371. The most important thing, though, is not just the numbers of enrolled, but the numbers who are completing their programs in certificates and degrees. And there, we've seen a healthy increase in the last year, and we're hoping that that momentum will continue. We're participating in a national program called Completion by Design, and we're really focusing our efforts to get people into pathways that will result in jobs. And that's what we want and need in our area, is more qualified people to take on the jobs that people are retiring from, or new jobs in our community. Now, just a few words about capital projects that are currently underway. The GOES Student Center, Phase 2. You remember that the GOES Center was built in 2007. It was built with funds mainly from the state bond of 2000. And we did get a significant gift from Craig Goez of Greenville Toyota. But we weren't able to really build the entire center like we had planned. And so now we've been able to go back, and we just today took over ownership of the Goez addition. And we'll have a formal ribbon cutting for that in the next few weeks. Haven't set the date yet. We have relocated our bookstore from the Vernon White Building to the new Craig Goez Center addition. We're also creating a new computer lab, a career center, which we really haven't had before at Pitt Community College. Very timely at this point when we're stepping up our K-12
connections with the business and industry in our area. And then also a student lounge that will provide space for our students who are there in between class. So it'll be a great resource for our community, especially for our campus. The big project we're working on is the new science building. This, as you remember earlier, the first part of this year, we announced a federal grant from the U.S. Department of Commerce of $2 million to help us expand that project to 75,000 square feet. It will be the largest building on the Pitt Community College campus, and we hope to break ground this summer for that building. It will be the home for most of our natural sciences, physical sciences, and for some training for business and industry. Biotechnology will also be incorporated in this new facility. And I'm really looking forward to seeing it become a reality. It will be located on the Bowen Farm, kind of across the Warren Drive from the Construction Industrial Technology Building in back of the Russell Building. So it's continuing to populate that Bowen Farm property. We've also purchased the basic law enforcement training facility. That's the Champions Physical Fitness area on the other side of Sam's Club from the campus. And while Greg Lassiter is the owner of Champions, is building a new facility on Fire Tower Road, we are receiving rent for that. And that is going right into our county fund balance. So, you know, we've documented that those rent payments. And we have also contracted with an architect to do some slight modifications in that facility. So when he does leave, which we're hoping will be in September or October, then we'll be able to move right in, retrofit the place, and then get BLET transferred over to that location. They're really looking forward to it, and we're looking forward to having them a little closer to campus. I know the town of Winterville is happy, too, because they get a little bit more feeling of safety. Probably helps out with the new ABC plans over there, too. A new development is the Early College High School. You've heard about that from Superintendent Lenker, I think, as well as from myself, and that will begin this fall. That will be located, at least initially, in modular units right to a little bit north of the Ed and Joan Warren building. It will start with 75 students enrolled this fall. A principal has been appointed, selected by the Board of Education, Mr. Whittington, and we are looking forward to the arrival of those students on our campus soon. It will be located in an area that we can access easily, the school buses and transportation. And after the first year, many of those students will be taking courses with our own students. So the amount of space that's separate for these students will be limited probably to their first 2 years. We'll be expecting an increase of 75 students for the next 5 years. So eventually, it will result in a high school of about 375 students. And I'm proud to say that Pitt County is a little bit late to the table in the early college high school, but we're benefiting from hearing about the experiences that are going on at other schools, other colleges. Just a refresher for you about the square footage of Pitt Community College in the context of growth of the campus over the last several years. You can see from this chart, from 2008 until 2013, we've had a significant increase in square footage. And really, since the year 2000, we've over doubled our square footage on campus. That's only appropriate as we've doubled our enrollment during this period too. What we've seen is a great utilization of space, an intense utilization of space. And I want to repeat what I've often said about our being a crowded campus, but it is true. And that means that with the crowded campus, you get a lot of wear and tear on buildings, many of which are 30, 40, even 50 years old. And that has been a challenge for us, is to keep these buildings maintained. And the new ones are not nearly as much of a problem, obviously, as the ones that have been around for a while. During this whole period, over the last 15 years, we've had the same capital support from the county for major projects like this, 75,000 a year. And we appreciate that. but we know that we're going to need a higher level of support in the future, and I'll point that out in a second. Our major maintenance requests for this next year are fairly significant. We have, for the Wichard Building, a new roof, a new boiler. For the White Building, also a new boiler. And for the Warren Building, a water heater system replacement. These projects are significant. I call them major maintenance requests, but they're not isolated. If you look on the page that I distributed to you, I think you all received an additional page which says major maintenance requests at the top. You should have received that in your materials. It outlines the next 5 years of requests that have been scheduled. And this is a total of $264,000 in 2016. In 2017, we're anticipating needs of about $222,000. In 2018, as much as $672,000. So we know that the maintenance requirements of the campus are going to be steady, and they will probably increase to a certain extent. Just an example of the kind of things we're talking about, the Catherine Witcher Building was opened in 1979. It houses our heating and air conditioning program and our graphic communications program, among others. It has a substantial challenge with the roof, and we are going to have to replace it. And then also with the boilers. You can't really get a picture of the deterioration in these photos, but it's significant, and we know that unless we invest in that facility soon, it's going to be a lot more expensive to replace it. Now, I'm really going to talk about two things, and I want to apologize to you for the capital proposal that was submitted to you earlier, actually in late 2014. Because it recounted a succession of projects that was in line with our master plan, but not very realistic about considering the resources of Pitt County and even our ability to go through the planning and all the work that we have to do with the State Construction Office on projects. So we want to focus our capital requests really in two areas. One is a fire alarm replacement. And secondly is renovation, not addition, to the Everett Building. The fire alarm replacement is an upgrade of our current system, which is a manual system. It will be in four different buildings, the Everett Building, the Wichard Building, the White Building, and the Whitley Building. Currently, these are manual systems with pull stations. We do not have smoke detectors or other modern features, and they are not tied to the EMS systems, require someone to call 911 if there's an emergency. We can do this fire alarm replacement in a phased process, so we could do one building 1 year, over 4 years, handle all four. There might be some savings in doing all at once, though. The major project I want to talk about is the Clifton Everett Building. Clifton Everett was a longtime chair of the Board of Trustees at Pitt Community College, and the Clifton Everett Building is the home for our library. Libraries are important parts of a college campus, regardless of what you hear about online learning and resources over the internet. They are heavily used, and on the Pitt Community College, if you go into the library anytime between 9 a.m. and 2 p.m. in the afternoon, it'll be standing room only. The thing that amazes me is how polite and civil the people are at respecting each other on their quietness, their need for study, and basically queuing up to use facilities that really are not nearly as numerous as they should be. The Everett Building was built in 1987. It has about 26,000 assignable square feet. And it was originally well suited for the enrollment that we had. Of course, in 1987, the enrollment was about one-third of what our current enrollment is. It was a little bit over 3,000 students, and we have over 9,000 students just in the fall term alone. In addition, we have a lot of community users of our library. Most people don't realize that, but we have about 8% of our circulation actually is done by community users. So we get a lot of traffic in that library. We've had 12,000 students use the library in 2012. And in 2014, we contracted with a consulting agency, Judith H. Close, and she did some comparisons of Pitt Community College's library with other large community colleges and found that of the ones that she selected, we were the lowest in terms of percentage of students which can be served and also in terms of the square feet per student. You see in some of these pictures how crowded it is. Well, our plan is to utilize the study that was done in 2013 and 14 and to learn from the recommendations that were made, which were there are too few group study rooms, collaborative areas. The original design really needs to be updated. And our primary goal is, with the first floor at least, to open it up more and be able to have more student use of the first floor. We also have a major challenge with the HVAC and electrical systems in the building. And you know, with technology having been such a big development in the last 20 years, that's caused real complications. But the basic problems are, again, as we've seen in many places on our campus, not enough seats for students during peak times and not enough room for computer stations to serve those students. We also will be needing some spaces in the library to support our early college high school program. We have decided that on the first floor where we have disability services, we need to relocate that disability services more to the back of the first floor area to provide better access for handicapped, for students with disabilities. And we know that without doing this, we are going to continue to be under tremendous pressure to really provide the support that students want and need to succeed at PCC. Summary of the cost of the project, and we've had an architect come in and take a look at the plan. We had MHA Works from Greenville, and the estimate was about $2.2 million. That is actually on the proposed capital plan that we submitted, but that's not counting the addition to the library. We're just looking to renovate the library now. As I said, we will relocate the Disability Services Department to more of the rear of the first floor. We will add additional PCs for student and community use, upgrade the HVAC and electrical systems for capacity building, and primarily create more space, both formal and informal space. We also need a larger space for bibliographic instruction for our students. It's amazing how students don't know really how to use a library, to use it as a tool. And it's important that we be able to communicate that. We mainly do it through our academic success courses or through our English classes. Now is a great time for us to do this job because we're relocating some of the staff that's in the library as we vacate the bookstore from the Vernon White Building. We'll be relocating some of the information technology staff that have been in there. So the timing is good. And we would like to get started on this as soon as possible. Even if it's not the entire amount that we've estimated for the project, we would be willing to do it in parts. And we know that this is something we have to start attacking. If we don't, our academic program will suffer. So that's our proposal. I'm sorry that the proposed projects that you saw on your plan are not what we have right now on the horizon. We're going to be working on a master plan, a new master plan for facilities in the coming year, and we hope to have a more realistic and comprehensive planned for your review in late 2015. Be glad to answer any questions that you have.
Does anyone have any questions for Dr. Massey?
I have one question.
Mr. Garris.
Dr. Massey, this may be too early in the process to have fully understood and digested this, but on the release from the governor's office on his budget, one of the items in there is that he is going to request a $1.2 to $1.4 billion general obligation bond to revitalize blighted state buildings, et cetera, et cetera. And those facilities are going to be for National Guards, community colleges, and other agencies. Are you familiar with this? And if that does come to pass, and I hope it does, is that going to lessen the pressure at the local level for capital dollars for community schools?
I certainly hope so, Commissioner Garris. I would like some of the good news that you have had recently in your dealings with the local legislators. And actually, I'm up in Raleigh this week talking with our team. We're very supportive of this initiative, but we haven't heard very much about it. Most of the rhetoric in terms of the public announcements have been about state office buildings more than community colleges. But he did include that in the wording. So we're receptive to it, and you can bet that I'll be at the front of the line and use some of the same arguments that I've used with you as why Pitt Community College is deserving.
Good. So maybe we can hold back on some of these local dollars until we see what's going to happen there.
Dr. Massey, I notice in your future projects you have a total of 6 HVAC projects. Mm-hmm. That is a skill that the college teaches, is it not?
It is.
So the outlook for employment in that field does seem bright.
That's true. Actually, you know, a number of our vocational areas are just booming. Welding, HVAC, yes. Electrical. We don't have any trouble. Our automotive technology is mm-hmm. another great example. We don't have any trouble for our students finding jobs. Mm-hmm. It's then affording to pay them when they get the jobs, that's more of the challenge.
And on a closing note, I saw your electronic bulletin board. And you're offering concealed carry permit classes.
Yes, we offer a real variety of non-credit services to the community through our continuing education program, and that's one of the ones we offer.
I was very proud
Thank
to
you.
See that, as I'm an alumnus from 1995 yes. of your college.
Okay.
That's all, Mr. Yes. Chairman. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Owens?
This is two phases.
Mr. McGlawhorn, you get
it. Yes. Dr. Massey, just a simplicity. On the paper I've got here, you got 2017 Wichard Building, modifications of HVAC controls. Then on 2018 Wichard Building, HVAC controls upgrade. What is the difference in that?
Mr. Owens, can you answer that? Rick Owens is our vice president for administration. I'll let him.
I didn't want to make a big to-do, but upgrades and modification to meet place along within the same line.
We've had several different programs move out. The modification to the system is actually a reconfiguration of the ductwork that runs within the building. The controls upgrade will actually allow us to remotely program, turn the building on, turn the building off. So if we have closures, our facility services folks can call in and turn the system down, turn the system up. It's part of our energy savings plan that we're working on. So those are
unexpectedly, I would wonder why you didn't do them both at one time.
It's kind of two different systems. Okay. I mean, it's one of them's ductwork, one of them's electronics.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Mr. McLaughlin.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Dr. Messer, I noticed that in recent announcements, you have announced about grants that you received, and I think they were very significant. I wonder what percentage of grant money would be used in terms of some of these major maintenance requests, or can it?
Well, we have not identified sources for these type of projects. They're a harder one to get at. But we'll certainly explore whatever opportunities there are. I'm not familiar with any that are out there, but we'll work at it. The difficulty is that the longer we wait, the more expensive the projects become. And in some cases, we've had to, in an emergency sense, do something sooner than we had hoped. And we try to avoid those situations because we don't have any flexibility once we disrupt services. We have to keep our business continuity plan has to continue. So we have to get about these as quickly as possible.
Ms. Ward?
Thank you for the presentation. The Everett, no, is it the Everett that's the library?
Yes.
Okay. We don't, do we have figures on that? We don't, or do we, as far as what you're looking at, and you said you were going to back it down a little bit. Is that the first project that you want to to get done?
Yes.
Do you have like an amount of money for the, you know, backing it out or for the total thing? It may be here somewhere, but I can't find it.
The renovation project that I described would be $2.2 million.
Okay. As a whole thing?
That's both floors, right. First and second floor. We could get a good start on that with half that amount of money.
Okay.
Because, as I mentioned, the first floor is the area we want to really spend some time on, right, redesigning and opening up for our students.
Right. So that could be the first step of the,
yes,
first step of the project. Okay. Thank you.
Mr. Manager, do you have something?
Yes, Dr. Mass, I wanted to ask you, we've mentioned in the past several times about guaranteed energy savings and the instrument that can be used to actually, a lot of your maintenance requests are dealing with energy-related modifications. Where do y'all stand with pursuing paying for these improvements via the energy savings that would result from implementing them?
One of the things that we've seen over the past several years, and I'm using rough numbers, is basically that we brought the Vernon White building online recently. We upgraded the controls there. We've dropped our energy usage significantly. We've remained kind of flat after adding on the, we saw a spike initially after adding on the Charlie Russell building, and we've dropped back almost to pre-Charlie Russell building levels as far as energy usage goes. So that is paying for itself. One of the issues that we run into is the newer buildings are more energy efficient, and the older buildings do not have the controls in them. So those are the buildings that you see being upgraded, but we do expect those to return.
So have you brought any outside consultants in to look at your facilities to see if the whole intent of the project is that a company will come in, make the improvements to the facilities, and the energy savings that are resulting from that then pays the debt payments for the improvements. And if the facilities do not meet or make the energy savings that are projected, then that company makes up the difference to make the debt payment.
My predecessors did look at, it's typically referred to as performance funding. My predecessors did look at that. I have not looked at that in the past 9 months that I've been in this position.
We've done it. We've done it twice. We've got two instruments that we've made improvements across all of our facilities in county government.
It is something we'll explore.
Any more questions? All right, thank you for your presentation.
Thank you.
All right. Next up, we have a budget amendment. Dr. Morrow. It's the next two are yours.
Thank you, sir. Good evening, commissioners.
Good evening.
The first budget amendment is in our personal health division. This is under the Healthy Start program. There have been some changes. That's a federal program that works with high-risk mothers in Pitt County until their child is 2 years of age. So this one is actually an expansion of Healthy Start dollars for Pitt County that would create a new position of a social worker, an additional social worker to work with these high-risk moms here in Pitt County. So the $14,850 is the amount for the rest of this current fiscal year to bring that person in.
Okay. We have a motion on that?
Yes, I'd like to make a motion that we accept this, and I know you are aware of our responsibility that when we bring people in with grants or money from a source that we don't look for that to be a permanent position unless
come up with this is all federal dollars.
So. Okay, thank you.
We have a motion. Is there a second? Second, Ms. Ward.
So you were saying when this grant runs out, then that person goes off the roll.
Yes, sir.
Okay, very good. Thank you.
Unless we have another job available for them that they're qualified for.
With funding.
Right. Yes, sir. That's a given. Got to pay them.
All right, let's vote on the motion.
Mr. Hannah.
Okay, Dr. Moore.
The second one is in our Health Education Division. This is a new CDC grant that we just got notice of. And this is on obesity, diabetes, hypertension, heart disease, and stroke prevention. This is, again, federal dollars from the CDC coming into North Carolina. We were one of five health departments that were selected in North Carolina to receive the grant. The $133,756 the grant is scheduled to start April the 1st. So it would create 2.5 new positions. One of those is a halftime fiscal person that would be contracts manager and also handle the finances and reporting to the state and to the CDC. Another position is a health educator that would be in charge of work sites and working with faith-based organizations like churches on improving access to healthy foods and increasing exercise and changing the environments that are leading to development of chronic disease for those worksite employees and for those people in those churches or faith-based, other faith-based organizations. The third position is a health systems coordinator. Again, a health educator, most likely, that would work with hospitals and clinics on improving the quality of care and the control of high blood pressure and the prevention of diabetes.
Ms. Ward?
I move that we accept this with the same information that we talked about before on the other one.
I'll second that.
Now, which one is that, Mr. Chairman?
This is number 2 under items for discussion.
I lost one. Okay.
I should say also that these three positions cover 9 counties. But
right. And, and I was going to say that we are one of, not everybody is getting it.
Correct.
All the counties.
Right.
I think we have some discussion from Mr. Owens.
Yeah, by way of discussion, locked on page 54, is this the motion that was made dealing with the figures on page 54?
Yes, sir.
Yes.
All right. On page 54, you say that's 2.5 positions.
Yes, sir.
For the 133,5 whatever thousand. Commend you first on getting the grant, but that's good. But as I read these figures on page 54, salary 33,412. Is that two salaries together or one?
It should be one. I'm not sure. I'm looking at the same thing you are. But this
you don't
is,
have one.
This funding
have
is
one
just from
hand
April.
Down there?
This so, funding is just from April 1st through June 30th.
All right.
If that's
so, you got it now, Doc?
Yes, sir.
So that salary is just for one salary, is that correct? Or two combined within a fiscal year or a calendar year or whatever?
3 months.
It's not even a year for multiple.
That is the 2.5 salaries just from April 1st through June 30th.
Okay. And yes, then one more thing on that. Auto expense $1,500 and travel $3,000. What's the difference in those two items?
Auto expenses would be your fuel, mostly just fuel and mileage expenses. So we've got to figure out whether these folks are using a personal car or a county car.
And the travel, what is that?
Travel would be related to training. So.
Now, contract services, what's that? I'm just curious. So.
Yeah, and I'm sorry, I don't have these
right.
answers better off the top of my head here.
I finished, Mr. Chairman.
Contract services, I'm sorry, that's the actual, we would contract with the work sites and with the churches. So those are funds that are going to those organizations.
So you're getting $133,500 a year. Is that correct out of this grant?
No, we'll get more than that.
No,
that's just for one period. Okay.
We have funds that come in through May the 31st, and then we'll have additional funding from June 1st through May 31st of 2016.
Okay, thank you.
It's pretty confusing for all of us.
There's no further discussion. Let's complete the vote.
Thank you.
But what does it do?
All right. Thank you.
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Ms. Keene and Ms. Roy.
Good evening, Mr. Chair, Commissioners. We're glad to be with you again tonight to just try and answer a couple of questions that came up during our last presentation regarding our Comprehensive Recreation and Park Master Plan. As we said earlier, in order to serve the needs, the parks and recreation needs in a large rural county, the best way is through the joint use of school facilities. When we look at facilities throughout the county on this map, the county facilities that are closest to the most people in our county are our schools. And again, Pitt County has been very successful in that over the years, and we're really known statewide for our joint use of school facilities and our school parks. A number of special designations and awards that have come to Pitt County, school parks and joint use has played a key role in those. You'll remember our Pitt Community designation, our National Association of Counties Recreation and Parks Achievement Award. Also, again, we were recommended community strategies and measurements to prevent obesity in the United States in 2009, and that was from the Centers for Disease Control. And also it played a role in our America's Promise Alliance 100 Best Communities. So again, these awards and these recognitions have come through collaborative efforts with all of our community partners and our community departments working together. One of the best things that's happened for us in Pitt County over the years is to have our director of Pitt County Community Schools and Recreation to be a person that has really grown up with the program, who started out with us and has given her entire career up to this point to the citizens in Pitt County. So Rita's going to talk a little bit. That's Rita Roy. She's going to share a little more information about community schools in our schools.
Hi, thank you. Thank you for having us. Community Schools and Recreation uses school facilities along with citizens of the county for recreation programs, offering to agencies, groups, individuals, and families, as well as we coordinate volunteers and other community resources. Development of parks on school facilities has been done through several different methods. One has been our capital outlay program, and it's been, we have about $700,000 over a 25-year period has gone to work to create $101.2 million to develop the parks that we have now, or auditoriums or multipurpose spaces that can be used by the school but also citizens, as well as our programs. And then we've worked with the recreation management program funds that were here, left us a few years ago. Hopefully they'll return to help organizations and also some facilities on school grounds. And then, of course, we work with grants, collaborative grants with our partners. Our programs include youth sports from 2 to 18. That includes camps, special activities, after school during the summer and on Saturdays. And then we also run the after school program in 10 schools currently, and has been as many as 15. And then we offer an adult fitness program, which may include volleyball, softball, and some basketball. And a lot of what we do for adults in using school facilities is to try to cover the utility fee when like Burroughs, or not Burroughs Welcome, DSM, or somebody has teams, or churches have teams that need to get in gyms. And that's our way of providing adult recreation in some form. Obviously, we're real big in senior games and senior exercise programs. We have over 34 program areas, that's youth through senior programs. So that's like soccer, two or three seasons of soccer, season of basketball, three seasons of volleyball, and so on. In 2013, and I believe you have this in front of you, we had, through our program, over 11,851 unduplicated participants. The question came up before about gymnasium and gymnasium spaces, and in the master plan, you'll see that we had to say that they were only available 50% of the time. That's very misleading. During the school year, they may be available 10% of the time, and the summer kind of helps us out. But a lot of the gyms are redone during the summer, so that number is actually a little high. We have 21 gyms. 9 of those are high schools. When gym space is needed for recreation, schools are using them. So, and then there's 11 middle school gyms, and we really only get them about 2 hours, 2 or 3 nights a week. And I believe you have a chart that talks about that also. During the season when everybody needs a gym, currently we have 53 basketball teams and 28 volleyball teams and over 14 senior games basketball teams that we're trying to get in the gyms on top of schools also using them. Use of facility. Anybody can use school facilities. We processed over 600 applications last year, and what you see here are just community folks. It may be a family reunion, community meeting, fair of some sort, but over 7,000 hours were used by over 46,000 people. Our after-school program by itself uses the schools for over 8,000 hours, so that number's not included in the top, and we have over 550 students that we see every day of the year, except for our holidays. When talking about where our funds come from, we think we truly maximize all of our resources. We use registration fees. There's the use of facility fees. They're not that bad. And grants, Pitt County and Pitt County Schools. We feel we cover the 6 dimensions of health through our programs. Again, Alice has said that, you know, we've been recognized by the CDC best practices because of our school facilities being available. A report I just did this morning said that, you know, so many people are not, 1 in 5 homes are within walking distance of a park, and that's we need more than that. We need things to be closer. Well, we would like you to adopt our comprehensive recreation and parks master plan.
Thank you for your presentation. Any discussion or motions from the board?
Well, adopting the plan, how much does that commit us financially?
It just commits us to the process. It doesn't commit
then
any dollars.
Then I would make a motion
time.
That we adopt the plan. It looks fine.
I second it.
Any further discussion?
Yes, I got a question.
Mr. Owens.
What does, while we're talking about this new plan, is that to be called the Parks and Recreation Master Plan, is that what that is?
Well, it is called a Comprehensive Recreation and Parks Master Plan.
Tell me how that is integrated into the local communities for the schools.
How community schools and recreation is involved, you mean?
I know when Alice started 100 years ago, she went around to every school. She had a program implemented at every school. How is this new plan going to suck? And you say you can't get into gyms at some time 80 or 90% of the time. How are you going to help those areas?
Well, all of our programs are based pretty much within schools around Pitt County. Now, in 2006, obviously, we have the Alice Keene Park now and those facilities. But with those numbers, we're still in the schools. This plan is to guide the county as well as our department on how to move forward. And we don't, if you compare us to other like-sized counties, we don't have the facilities. A lot of the facilities we do have are because of the schools, because we have access to the schools. It was a great idea, and there's no way we could have financially the centers, one in Bethel and one at Chicot and one in Farmville. It's absolutely necessary that the schools are used and community schools and recreation due to the Pitt County Board of Education and the Pitt County Board of Commissioners 37, 40 years ago, coming up with that agreement is, I mean, we're part of it because we provide the recreation in Pitt County through the schools.
The park out here on County Home Road does a great job. You serve a great number of people. But if I glean from what you said, say the school up in Bethel is not getting any attention. Is that correct?
Right. No, we
tell
offer
me what you're giving them then.
We offer, we've tried to do a community garden there. We've offered basketball programs there. We offer soccer. We offer all of our programs in every location that doesn't already have something. Like, we won't go to Farmville and try to create a basketball program because they have one, same as in Aiden. But we'll go to the Pactolus area, to the Stokes area, to the Bethel area, those areas, and say, would you like a basketball program? Now, we can't help it if people don't register and we don't get the numbers. And we do still try to keep people, you know, if only two or three sign up in Bethel, we try to keep them together and we bring them to Welcome.
How about Falkland?
Falkland is included. We don't have, other than we've helped with their trail and their playground there. We offer an after-school program until last year, and we probably will be looking at that again. But yeah, we do work at.
How about north out on the highway?
Northwest.
33.
Northwest. When they first started, we.
You do anything for them, is what I'm saying.
Yeah, we've done their playground. We've got a trail out there. We work with a person who's currently working on their softball field. I mean, their baseball area, because they'd like
and
to start
spend
a baseball.
Money out there.
Yes, sir.
It might be good to know where they're spending
them. Where I'm coming from is people in these various schools that I just mentioned here. Mm-hmm. They say, well, we're only here by name. Like you say, the Farmville Recreation Department said, well, we do. I was over here. Mm-hmm. Now, maybe they don't, but maybe Aiden does too. And I think, and this sheet that you have here, you talk about Aiden Bethel, you got available. Why you got available if you're not using it? Now, some people say they're not being used. A little further and I quit. G.R. Whitfield, on this it says available. Hope Middle, volleyball. You go right on down and, I've just been thrust upon me that most of the time is spent out on County Home Road, mm-hmm. and most of the money is spent out there, and that the local communities are not receiving that, whether it's fact or not. And that's why I told Alice about when you were here last time about the money going where and who it was coming from and where it was going, and I've made my argument.
And we take that to heart. You ask anybody on my staff, I am constantly telling them we cannot centralize. That is not what community schools and recreation is about. That's a great facility, and I don't know what people did before that was built because it is used 100% of the time. But our programs are out in the schools. And if we try to work with everything, we work with staff at schools, we work with their playgrounds, we put trails just about everywhere, but we can't force students to come to a program. We offer it though, we do offer it. And
two
we try
questions,
to communicate.
Two more questions, Mr. Chairman. Go ahead. In this overall new proposal that we're talking about voting on here tonight, is that gonna require more land out on County Home Road?
This simply just gives us a guide, what we have, what we need.
We had mentioned before about building a new gym, $5 million gym out there.
And that would be in the site plan, and we haven't brought
and,
that.
And so the overall plan would include more land and a gym out there. Is that what you're telling?
The gym, the land's already there for the gym. There is a little track of woods where they're talking about putting a natural trail.
How many miles of track you got out there?
1.3.
All right.
And it connects with
Senior Citizen? It's connected with the Senior Citizen track?
There's not a trail on their area, but yeah, we're right there.
Okay. Thank you. Appreciate it.
Mm-hmm. Anyone else? Ms. Ward?
Well, all I want to say is what I have experienced in the past when I was a principal in four different schools in the county. And like you said, you can offer a program and you get the word out to your community in all ways. And the after-school program in almost all the schools is part of community schools. Baseball programs in some of these outlying areas. I know G.R. Whitfield used to have a constant. I don't know whether they're doing it now or not.
They,
I know
they
Bethel,
still do.
Bethel had baseball going on, almost like a little league program. Soccer does not just go on out there on County Home. It goes on at these different school sites. And with a county the size that we are, without the community and schools program connection between the schools and the county commissioners, there would be a lot less recreation available and programs available, such as the walking trails and those sorts of things for all the citizens, not just the students, but the adults also. I know that Welcome at one time, you never passed by that parking lot day or night that there was, I mean, at night, not during the day when the school is in, but during the summer that it wasn't full. So I think everybody knows this is dear to my heart, and I would, when it's appropriate, and this is just a plan. We're always telling everybody to have a plan, a 10-year plan, a 15-year plan. Don't just come in and throw something at us. And all this is we are saying we approve of the plan, or we support the plan, not so much an approval. And I'd like to make a motion that we accept the plan.
I had a question.
Sorry, made second.
It has been made in second.
Yeah.
Oh, that's right, and I seconded
that's
it.
That's right, and then
I thought we were way back on
Mark
the other one. I got you, Charles.
Hat on and
I got you.
Commissioner Wood.
It looks like a good plan, but people look at where money is spent, and they look at what is there. I'm a new board member. I like to know if you're spending monies at other places as you are on County Home Road. Yes, you do have programs other places, and they may not be attended, but what is the focus of where you're placing dollars as to what's there? Because if you look at the Field of Dreams in Bethel, the town can't even afford to even cut the grass. And so why aren't you helping communities like that, and even Fountain. To me, where you put the money is where people tend to go. And those people who don't have the transportation to get to County Home Road has another expense of being in the street. We have little boys skating on the bridge the other day that almost got hit because he was on a skateboard. And there isn't a skateboard park that I know of anywhere. So the children are at risk because their parents can't afford to drive them or take them. So a good recreation plan for a county like Pitt County should be a bit more evenly focused in the outlying areas. And maybe you should look at some way of having use for those outlining areas, because that's one of the big things that the people in Belleville want was a good recreational park-like area where they can have a good game of baseball. And it just doesn't exist.
You're exactly right. The plan, though, will probably tell us, it will tell us, that those kind of facilities are necessary if we want to come up to par with like-sized counties. That plan's not going to tell you that we need more ball fields or playgrounds on County Home Road. We do need them. We do need them in northern Pitt County. And we need money, too.
Good. Mr. Colson.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Hammond.
As I was looking at the summary of information, and it read that, as we discussed on March the 2nd, I want you to know, haven't been no more meetings to discuss anything with this board since March the 2nd until today. And so I thank you for reminding us of that, but you are here tonight to ask for the adoption of the plan. Additional information that has been provided, I don't think have had as effects to change the adoption of the, to make ready the adoption for the plan yet.
And our thinking was you had some questions and we knew we were coming back to ask for this adoption, that we would try to address some of the questions that you had in the last meeting.
Mr. Colson.
So it really boils down to money. If you were to take and take a map and take a compass and go out about 5 miles and draw a circle around where you are currently right now on County Home Road, how much of the population do you think you would take in?
58%.
58, okay, close to two-thirds. That's what I was just throwing a dart at. Okay, now, let me ask you this question. If we were to proportionalize the amount of money you get and you were forced to take away from County Home Road area where the majority of people are and divvy it out in small little bits into the outer areas, what kind of program would you actually have? Would it be a successful program or would it be far less than what you have now?
Are you talking about us operating programs in the small?
I'm saying that if you have, if you've got $100,000, mm-hmm, and you got to take 40% of that money that you're now, that you now have, and you are forced to put them in all these other areas that have been talked about in small amount, $4,000 here, $3,000 there, and $9,000 over here, but you don't have but 60,000 of that 100,000. What kind of a program would you have at County Home Roads? Would it be successful or would it be
absolutely
far less than what you have now?
Absolutely. We would by hook or crook figure out.
I'm sorry?
It would be less.
Your it would be less. Staff would be less.
Well, my point being is that the majority of people live in Greenville, Winterville, the Aiden area, and they live there for a reason. And while I think that you're trying to do the best you can in the outlying areas, I think that if we did try to more balance the money going out to these areas, you wouldn't have as effective a program at County Home Road. That'd be my assessment of it. And so if we want more as a county, you know, maybe this board needs to step up and put a little bit more forward to give more to the area. As a manager of a business, and we keep talking about trying to bring businesses into Pitt County, one of the things that in a community that businesses look for is not just roads. That's important. Mm-hmm. They look for schools, they look for success, they look at the community, they look at the hospital, they look at a lot of things. They also look at the elderly, and they look at at what's available from a standpoint of recreation. All those things make a healthy community.
Correct.
I personally am for the Greenway. I personally believe that we as county commissioners should do something more like is being done in Wake County, where you got miles and miles and miles of walking that you can do up there. It's just a fabulous community. It was done after the fact, but it's like we're following in the same pattern that all the other communities are. We're always behind the eight ball. We're never doing things that are truly, I'm going to say, advanced for where they ought to be. It costs less to do it sooner than it does than to wait and do it later. My point being is I think you do a great job for what you have. And I think everybody on this board believes that. But we as a board, if we're ever even going to think even to remotely be critical of you, then we need to start to think about how do we fund you better. That was a statement. I'm not asking rhetorical. I'm not asking for an answer. Thank you.
Mr. McLaughlin.
Thank you, Michelle. You've heard a lot about transportation and maybe getting to some of these rural areas. And I do know that there's a number that you have to have in terms of justifying a program. But in view of what I'm hearing, you know, especially in these rural areas and north of the river and other places, do you have in your master plan a plan for transportation that maybe periodically they could come out to certain designated places to get to the Alice King Park? Is that part of your master plan?
There's not a plan to correct that. That is seen as a problem in the master plan. That there's not a plan to how do we fix that, but it is addressed in the master plan that is an issue. Transportation is an issue.
And I think that's something that you really maybe need to spend some time on in terms of trying to get something implemented in that area.
And if I may, when we have an area like in Bethel or in Grimesland where we have a hard time, but we're successful in other ways, we try to do a little more for a little less. You know, we had a summer reading program that was absolutely free, that would run 2 hours everywhere else, but we ran it 6 hours in Grimesland so that they could have lunch, come in early. We've done the same thing at Bethel, and the numbers, we treated them more like a day camp, which was paid, instead of a free reading program, and gave them field trips and that sort of thing, and the numbers still dropped.
Any other questions? All right. We've had a motion and second and a lot of discussion. Let's go ahead and vote.
One more.
Mr. Hammond.
Yes. Mr. Chairman, I'd like to say to Alice and her assistants that she can remember very well when I used to get up early because my wife did not drive and bring her to the exercise class out at Bell Fork. Well, one day I can recall that I was carrying some chairs to a family's house in Morwood who had lost their mother. And her daughter came out, "Why come you don't ever bring Peggy over here to this gym to the program in the morning?" And I just told her that I was already involved in one. "What you doing involved in one and this one right here? I haven't never seen you here." That was at the Third Street program down there. Well, Ralph Love was a member of the school board before he got sick like me and got to the extent that he couldn't be up there any longer to serve, and he came and got me on a Thursday and rode me to North Pitt School and to several other high schools in the area, and he was doing what Commissioner Tom Colson was talking about then, was sharing the different the facilities that was at one school relative to the other school in the county. And you don't want him on your case when he's trying to program his point. And so I had to see him a.m., midday, mid-afternoon, and early evening for about 3 weeks. And he sold me on equipment at North Pitt School. And I'll never forget that. And Alice, you had a very good program out at the center out at Bell Fork, but I got beat up. I ain't voting for you no more, David Hammond. I'm right in your district, and you ain't never had your foot down here in the morning to not one senior program. And your gray-headed self, you old too now. And I didn't say another word. I just threw my hands up. Well, I was down there. I was to that program because that was the one that Peggy started at. And I transported her, and I got some mileage with my wife by being in that morning program. Because if it hadn't been for that morning program, as that young lady said right there, a lot of times I'd be at Harvest going over the newspaper or the obituary column or something else. And I have been called for obituary, for a funeral, for a death call while I was at the center with the program. And thank you, Tom Coulson, for the way you put that. People, when they're in the county, they watch all things. They watch the location of the facility, the equipment, the roads, and the safety areas, and all of those things locked in. And as Mary was saying, there are some areas that feel like that they have been denied and passed over and all, while others are blooming and going forth. Mark Owens got a level head over there, and he was saying that earlier. Where is the money being spent? Is it being spent to at one place at a community school, or is it being spent universally over the county?
We do offer that same program that you brought your wife to in Bethel. We offer that same program that you brought your wife to in Bethel and in Farmville and in Aiden.
Right.
So we do spread
that. Thank you, ma'am.
Well, let's complete the vote.
Okay.
Sam.
Okay.
All right. Next, Mr. Elliott. Thank you, guys. With an appointment to the Vidant Medical Center Board.
Actually, number six is the Pitt County Nursing Home, unless you want to do Vidant first.
I'm sorry, I got too many check marks. Yes. Yeah. Let's do it in order.
Okay, on page 60, you've got the reappointments and appointments to the Pitt County Nursing Home and Adult Care Community Advisor Committee. In terms of reappointments, you've got Everett Branch, Calvin Henderson, being recommended for reappointment. There's two people. You have six people that are being recommended to be new appointments. That would be Rebecca Tindall, Eric Williams, Michael Weimer, Malcolm Smith, Ernest Lee, and Russell Hemby.
Mm-hmm. Motion to appoint and reappoint those names on page 60.
Six. Second.
Let's vote.
Thank you.
All right, next we have the Vidant Medical Center Board.
Yes, Mr. Chairman. On this one, this is the seat being vacated by Commissioner McLawhorn, who resigned back in January. And on this appointment, we have included the list of board members that you have appointed, and we did not include any applicants because for the past 15 years, this seat has been occupied by practice by a commissioner.
Mr. Chairman.
Yes, ma'am.
I'd like to recommend Commissioner Owens to fill this position.
Are there any other nominations?
I will second that.
Okay. Ms. Williams?
Didn't this come up before the Vidant appointment?
That was a different.
At the last meeting, you filled the spot that Ralph Hall had resigned, and you appointed Phil Dixon for that.
Yes.
Didn't we
Mr.
get a
Manager,
letter about cultural diversity? Yeah. I thought I was talking.
Mary, I voted no on that, and I wanted the board to know why, and that was because we had recommendations from the Vidant board. We had procedure from our clerk. We didn't follow any of it, and Phil Dixon wasn't even on the, didn't even have an application on file. So we had a lot of contention.
He did have an application on file.
He did.
But that's passed. What's done is done. And I agree with Mark Owens being on that board.
This is a seat that's traditionally held by a commissioner, is what this appointment is.
This is a commissioner. Okay. Because I want to remind us that we did say, and they did ask for some culture diversity. Am I not correct?
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you.
For the next seat, Mr. McLaughlin.
I just wanted to echo what Commissioner Mary Perkins Williams stated, that we do want to continue to build on diversity, but I think as a procedural, this has been filled by a commissioner, so we wanted to certainly try to. But I think we ought to always be mindful that we have to reflect the community in which we serve. So
Seeing no other nominations, let's vote. Mr. Hammond.
Day.
What was that?
Vote, honey.
Just one moment. Let me make this note to that.
He wanted to make a note relating to the culture diversity and that we were going to wait, and so no strain on Mark, but since it is a commissioner, I guess we don't hear what I want to be on there.
All right, then now we have number six, which was the original number four from the consent agenda. Mr. Farley, you asked that that be pulled. You want to discuss it?
Yes, I could speak to that, Mr. Chairman. That's one of my favorite things, drafting resolutions, and this one was, you know, it's needed, but it's a bit over the top with 17 whereases. And I looked at it, and we can strike number two and number six whereases, and that'll be fine with me, and we will still have the original intent of what we're trying to do and honor all the social workers, and will not be, unless you really want me to dig into why I want them struck, if you, I think you'll get a majority vote on that.
So number two and number six.
Let me get back to the page. Let me see here.
It's on page 39. Maybe we'll take a minute to review it. Did you make a motion to strike those, Mr. Farley?
Yes, I will.
Mr. Elliott, if you'll read those two out, number two and number six, so we can see about
number
a second.
Two and
okay,
six.
This is the proclamation for Social Work Month 2015. Whereas number two reads, whereas, comma, social work pioneers have helped America struggle for social justice and pave the way for positive social change. Then the number the sixth whereas says, whereas social workers continue to work to improve the rights of women, African Americans, and other ethnic minorities in the LGBT community.
You wanted those, your motion is to remove those entirely?
Yes, please.
Okay.
I'll second it.
All right, we've got a motion and a second. Any further discussion? All right, no further discussion. Mr. McGlohorn.
Now, the statement was where social workers continue to work to improve the rights of women, African Americans, and other ethnic minorities and the LGBT community. Are we saying that? The social workers do not do that?
No, we're saying they help everybody, even white trailer trash, homeless, winos, everybody. This says we're going to put extra emphasis on these groups. That's not good. That's my thinking, Ellen. We should be helping everybody equally.
Well, could we reword that?
Be my guest.
Including everybody. I mean, you know, just make a statement that I don't know. I don't think we need to do just remove it. I think that we may
social workers continue to work to improve the rights of all citizens of Pitt County. All citizens of Pitt County. You're eliminating the identification of groups. I mean, to satisfy all citizens. How about all citizens of Pitt County?
And then strike everything else.
Yeah.
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 I'll go with that.
That's in which paragraph?
It's
two or six.
Number six.
Okay. You did have a second.
Yes.
Make a substitute motion.
Is there a substitute
like
motion to the
effect? I'd like to offer a substitute motion that we change the wording in number six to read, whereas social workers continue to work to improve the rights of all citizens of Pitt County.
I'll second that.
Motion made and second. Any further discussion? All right, let's vote. Was a substitute motion to also exclude paragraph two, or was that to?
I second it.
Or was that to Was that to leave paragraph two in on the substitute motion? Let's just vote on what we have for now, and then we'll return to the original motion for number two. Let's go ahead and vote on the new wording for paragraph six. All right, thank you. In the matter of the second paragraph that was moved and seconded to be removed from the resolution, Madam, I'll defer to the parliamentarian.
I'm gonna take, I like that one.
So,
did the substitute motion?
Strictly speaking, a substitute motion would cancel out the underlying motion. And so, since it passed unanimously, strictly speaking, you would not go to the original motion. However, this case was a little unusual in that the substitute motion only changed a portion of the original motion. And so, it's really within your discretion, Mr. Chairman, as to whether or not you allow this board to vote on the remainder of the original motion as if it were separate, or if you'd like to entertain a new motion altogether as it relates to paragraph two.
Considering that Mr. Farley seconded, and I'll consider his intention was to remain as the original motion with the amended language.
I'll withdraw that at this time.
Yeah, because, I mean, when
I'll
you talk
that,
about...
Yeah.
Mr. Farley, when you talk about pioneering that helped to lead to the struggle of social justice.
Social justice, that's it. What is that? Now, that could be in high school, every boy's got the right to take a pretty girl to the prom. That's social justice. I don't like the wording of it. I know I'm being a bit lawyerly here, but that's, no. You strike social justice or come up with a better term, I'll be okay with it. See what I say, Mayor?
Well, take out social. But I really like the pioneering leader,
yes.
Okay? Let's just take out the social, okay?
Make a motion.
We have to have a motion.
So move that we strike social and we leave the rest of it there.
I still second it.
To satisfy your concern
motion
about
and
social.
Second. Let's vote. Mr. Hamm.
Did you get it, Dave?
Yeah, I got it. Done voted.
Try it one more time. It didn't read. Thank you.
It's all that training there, sir.
All right. Everybody okay on that? All right.
Yes.
So, just to make this go a little longer, there's been a closed session suggested. Madam Attorney, if you want to tell us about it.
Yes, Mr. Chairman, it has been suggested that this board go into closed session pursuant to North Carolina General Statute 143.318.11A6 with regard to personnel and 143.318.11A1 to prevent the disclosure of confidential information. With that, you would need a motion and a second.
Thank you.
Second.
I got the fine, man.
Let's vote.
And this vote is to go into closed session.
It's in the car. I bet you.
Vote down there. Let's go.
There's a vote on the floor for a closed session.
They're going to get me.
Welcome back. We're now to closed session.
I was informed.
Mr. Hammond.
Mr. Hammond, just a moment. You want me to do it?
We have a motion on, just a second, Mr. Hamm. Go ahead.
I'd like to make a motion that we accept the closed session minutes from our December the 15th meeting, 2014, for content only.
Motion and a second. Let's vote. All right, we'll do commissioner's comments. We'll start with you, Mr. Hammond. Go ahead.
Yes, sir. I was informed a few moments before we had this last vote by Dr. Morrow that Iowa County was not on this list, but his finger went along there where Johnston is and said we was cheaper than we was under all of those from there down to Rowan. And
it's out of order.
We can't. That's a personnel issue. We can't discuss that.
Huh?
We can't discuss that here. It's a personnel issue. We're not allowed to discuss
it. Get back on camera.
Do you have any other comments for closing?
Okay, then.
The last time we were in session, I asked you all to make that trip from Pitt Community all the way around. I certainly hope, if you haven't done it, that I ask you to please make that drive again to that area. You'll get to understand what I'll be talking about.
Yes, ma'am. Mr. Colson?
No comment.
Mr. Owens?
I want, on behalf of myself and the board, to thank Melvin for the service he rendered to the citizens of this county by serving on the Violet Medical Center Board for the term that he had. And I'm sorry that due to circumstances, he had to take leave soon. Secondly, I want to thank this board for the vote of confidence that you gave it to me. I don't believe I've ever accepted anything this board offered without a unanimous vote. Mary half-handedly did that. But I hope she'll be pleased with my diversity and my culture, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Ms. Ward?
No comment.
No comment.
Mr. Farley?
Just returned from the UNC School of Government, and we learned all about how the chairman is empowered. And as a presiding officer, you can open the meeting and close the meeting, Mr. Chairman.
Y'all sure didn't act like I was empowered, didn't I? All right, with that, do we have a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Got my goodness, Tom, man.
It's over.
Morning, you sleeping?
It's almost over. You got to vote.
Which should be easy.